With your loose change and dollar bills, you can impact the lives of those of our community who are facing the crisis of unexpected pregnancy. Your baby bottle could literally change or save a life. Anyone can fill a baby bottle. Invite your family, your friends, little ones, teens, neighbors, and coworkers to fill a bottle too. The funds raised will help us as we serve moms, dads, and their babies each day, offering help, support, and the resources they need to make a life-affirming decision. Your change will help us provide pregnancy tests, life-changing counsel, education, baby supplies, and more. Take your bottle home and fill it to the top. When you return your bottle, you are giving the gift of hope. Thank you for making a difference for life.
How's this? That better? All right. Everybody's a witness. Miss Beverly helped me get turned on today. All right. Good to see everybody this morning. God is good. And all the time. Amen. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Amen. Oh, I tell you what, it is good to be in the house of the Lord. Good to be in air conditioning. I hope y'all have enjoyed the heat. Tuesday's the first day of summer, in case you didn't know. So it's coming. We hadn't experienced summer yet. It's on the way. God was just teasing us, right? But anyway, we're so thankful. Good to see each and every one of you here this morning. I know we're having a good summer thus far. And thank y'all for coming. Welcome to all of our online guests joining us. We love you. Praise God for you. Let's see. Got some things to take care of this morning. We need to color a brick this morning, Johnny. All right. Praise the Lord. And while he's doing that, the youth camp coming up. We need some sponsors for youth camp. If you will get with me or Pastor Frank or Trey after the service, if you are interested in helping out with that, and we may need more, but right now we know we need 5. So keep that in mind. The new small group that started with Tracy and Johnny, so glad for that. That started last week. We're going to continue at 5 o'clock downstairs. Then Vacation Bible School, woohoo, starts tomorrow night, all week long. Amen. In case you hadn't noticed, and I've been contemplating sitting over here at the table and preaching, if that's all right with y'all. I've never sat up under an umbrella and preached before. So, anyway. Vacation Bible School this week, 5:30 each night. Pick up your kids by 8:30, or we'll sell them at the yard sale, okay? All right. If you have not registered, go ahead and go to pinegrove.us, get your kids registered there, get their T-shirt size in. T-shirts have been ordered, but hopefully we got enough for everybody. Baby bottles. We've got a bunch of them in, got some more brought in this morning. I think we got just a few more out there in the foyer, 5 of them if you did not get one, or if you want to do another one, that's all right too. But I cannot say enough about how much I love Pine Grove Church. I know we ask a lot out of you, but you have never failed to give. And I thank God for your hearts and your generosity. I appreciate you so much. Today is Father's Day. So I know I didn't get to everybody, but happy Father's Day to every father. It takes more to be a daddy than just biological. I'll go ahead and tell you that. I have seen that with my own eyes. My dad, my biological dad, took on three kids that were not biologically his, but I can promise you this, five young'uns raised in that household, he treated every one of them the same. It didn't matter to him. Everybody was going to do right and act right, and if somebody got out of line, he gave you the love of a dad. So appreciate him and all you fathers. We do have a gift for our dads, so if you will, dads, stand up, and I'll finish the announcements while our gifts are being given out. We got just a few gifts for you, so take care of that. Don't sit down until you get your gift. I know we got some of them upstairs, some of them downstairs. If you have a prayer need, connection card in the bulletins. Believe it or not, we had bulletins today. Hadn't had them in a month because of the guy doing the bulletins. We're about to fire him, so that would be me. Anyway, we do have bulletins, connection cards. If you have a prayer request, I know we've got a lot of sick folks, folks traveling, this, that, and the other. So remember all of those. Also, if you're interested in updating your updating your information, or interested in maybe becoming a member of Pine Grove Church, fill out a connection card, let us know. Growth Track and Celebrate Recovery, keep those in mind. All right, we got everybody. We got two upstairs up in the balcony. You going to let me serve the gospel out the window? So I'm on preach from the table this Sunday and from the truck next Sunday, right? All right, church, y'all ready to worship the Lord? All right, let's go.
Everybody, and happy Father's Day. We love y'all and appreciate you. But let's worship the Heavenly Father this morning.
Drink of the water, come and Come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting. God so loved the world.
We've had rough Sundays, but I don't think we've ever lost a wheel before. But we lost a wheel, and that kind of, that was hard to recover from. But praise God, he's got control of it.
They're still at the mention of his name. They'll say, my God is still the same. Past the walls, if they're still fall at the mighty sound of praise.
They'll say, my God is still the same. When did he break his promise?
Your trust.
defender, deliverer, King of kings, he is, he is.
To the
again, happy Father's Day. And love y'all and appreciate you so much. I was thinking and, you know, contemplating what to preach today. I've already fallen short because I don't think I'll ever preach this other wheel off. They sang the wheels off the bus. Jesus take the wheel. He done took one. He's looking for the other one. Amen. All right. Well, we do want to talk about Father's Day today. And just like on Mother's Day, when we did the message, it was not just to mothers. This is to everybody. This is not just to dads. This is to everybody. And so, you know, looking through Scripture, and you try to find, you know, good examples, and there's some in there. There's some good examples of, you know, fathers. Job, I think, was one of the most outstanding fathers in Scripture as far as earthly fathers. But then again, praying about it and just seeking the Lord, who can be a better father than our Heavenly Father? I can tell you this from experience, and some of you can, you're with me, and then some of you, you've done a much better job than me. I can say I have fallen short many, many times as a dad, as a husband, you know, every area I have testified of this, I have fallen short. But your Heavenly Father, He has never fallen short one time. Never. He will never fail you. He will never give up on you. He's not going to quit on you. I don't care where you go, what you've done. Our Heavenly Father loves us. So that's what we're going to talk about here this morning. We're actually going to go through the Lord's Prayer in Matthew chapter 6. If you want to turn there in your Bibles, you can. Or if you want to flip on your device, you can. But let's go to the Lord in prayer, and then we'll get started. Your gracious Heavenly Father, sir, we do thank you for this day, and thank you for your love, your grace, and your mercy. Thank you for this time together with the saints. God, I just pray your blessings upon each and every one. Father, help us to hear what your Spirit is saying to us, the church. Lord, we love you, we praise you, we thank you. In Jesus' name, and everyone said, amen. We'll go through this as normal. I'll go through verse by verse and we'll jump around a little bit. Not really a whole lot to add to it, but at the same time, it says so much in this prayer. And so we're just going to kind of go through it. In verse number one, it says, and this is Jesus speaking all the way through. He says, in this manner, therefore, pray. So Jesus is teaching us how to pray. First thing he says in that prayer is, our Father in heaven. Now, let's stop right there because everybody's father is not in heaven. You remember when the Pharisees were challenging Jesus and they were really giving him a hard time? What did he say to them? Do you remember? He said, you are of your father, the devil. You see, in order for us to have a father in heaven, we have to be children of God. Otherwise, our father is Satan, and I know. He used to be my father. He used to be my dad, spiritually speaking. And I did his deeds just like the Pharisees did. But friend, I want you to know, there is a God in heaven. He desires for every human being to be his child. Peter tells us, he tells us that God is not willing that anyone should perish, but that all should come to repentance. How do we come to repentance? Through Jesus Christ. God gave his only begotten Son that whosoever would believe in him, would trust in him, would commit their life to him, would not perish but have everlasting life. Whosoever would believe in him. As I have grown in my faith and grown in the God-given knowledge, and I've said this before, but the English language sometimes sells us short. And I would encourage you, as much technology as we've got today, there is no reason why we cannot dig into the depths of God's Word. Because when you read that, and I do not read Greek or Hebrew, but I can read English fairly well, when you read through that and you find that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son that whosoever would believe, the word believe there is not just a head knowledge. It is the Greek word pisteuo, and it means to embrace, to cast everything that you've got. And it's kind of like there is no saying growing up on the farm, don't put all your eggs in one basket. The mentality behind that is because from the chicken coop to the house, if you fall and you got all your eggs in one basket, they're all broken, or many of them will be. So take two baskets with you, put some in one, some in the other. Maybe some of them will survive. But here's the deal. When you trust in Almighty God, when you pisteuo God, when you put your faith, your hope, your trust in God, you can put all your eggs in one basket. As a matter of fact, he calls us to put all of our eggs in that basket, in his basket, in his care. The Bible declares to us that whatever we place into God's hand, he is just and able to keep. And he's able to do exceedingly and abundantly more than we can ask or even imagine. Now, the thing about God's hand is massive. I love when I read in the Old Testament and it talks about all the waters. Now, I've had the privilege, the blessing of being able to go to the Atlantic Ocean, to the Pacific Ocean, to the Gulf of Mexico, to the Gulf of California. Just been in tremendously large bodies of water. And I can tell you, when you're just a few short miles, and that does not include the Indian Ocean and all these other oceans that the world has, the seas, the rivers, all that. But I've seen enough to know there's a lot of water on this planet, a lot of it. And when you begin to fathom that in the hollow, that little small part of the hand, when you ever had the occasion, I know some of you grew up in the city, and that's okay, I'm not against city folks. Even city folks may have this opportunity to dip water in your hand, just cup, and just take a sip. You ever had that? All the water in the world was in the hollow of God's hand. And the Bible declares to us, now think about it, water, I don't know what it is, what, 7 or 8 pounds per gallon, something like that? All that weight was in God's hand, and he never strained. He never strained. He never struggled. It was never more than he could bear. He just kind of poured it out on the earth when he formed the earth. And here's one of the ironic things. To me, it's ironic. Sand, the Bible tells you, you don't want to build on sand, but what is it that keeps the oceans in their boundaries? Sand. You know why? Because your heavenly Father said you can come this far and no further. You see, all he has to do is speak, and he speaks to us every single day. He speaks to us through his word. He's encouraging us. He's calling us. He's trying to spur us on to do, as they said in the song, Jesus has gone home, but just for a little while, we still got work to do. But friend, I want you to know that every single day God is calling us to our work. Our Heavenly Father is calling us, and he's encouraging us on in the fight because our time here is short. What do you mean short? Some people live a day. Some people live, 100 or more years. But it's just like a vapor when it's compared to eternity. Our Father in heaven, and he cares about each and every one. And he is calling us to be adopted. How do you do that? By accepting Jesus Christ. That's the only way that the Father in heaven can be our Father, is if we are adopted. You see, the Bible declares that we have been strangers. In other words, God knew about us, but he didn't know us relationally. He formed us in our mother's womb, but he didn't know us relationally until we accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Then we can call him Father. We have been adopted, and we can call him Abba, Father, or daddy, father. He says, hallowed be your name. Holy is your name. So many times in our culture and growing up and being around where we are in this world, God's name is taken in vain so many times. And for the children of God, that ought to grieve us because His name is holy. You see, you can go around, you can go and stand at the gates of hell, and you can whisper Ricky all day long, and nobody's going to do anything. But you whisper Jehovah, or you whisper Elohim. Remember, we went through the names of God here a few months ago. I want you to know, Elohim is the plural, the Hebrew for God Almighty. And in that is contained the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Why? Because God, our Father, He is holy. Holy is His name. When we pray in His name, in God's name, or in Jesus' name, friend, we have invoked heaven. We have, I think it was Charles Spurgeon. And I know I reference him a lot. Friend, if you don't have a favorite author, I want to encourage you to read the Bible, but man, get somebody else to add to it, to add to your knowledge. Two of my favorites is absolutely Spurgeon and Tozer. I could sit and read Tozer all day long, but I love Spurgeon too. Sometimes a little hard to get my teeth into it. But Spurgeon said this. He said, it does not matter, and I know I'm not doing it verbatim, but I'll give you the good gist of it anyway. It does not matter how long you pray. It is how life you pray. He says, you can pray all day long, but if you have not touched heaven, then you've prayed in vain. But if you pray but for a moment in earnest and just this God felt this agony inside of it, if you pray but a moment, then there is life in your prayer and you've touched heaven. Friend, I want to encourage you. Hallowed be thy name. Hallowed is His name. That means He is holy and we can come into the presence of holiness. Before Jesus Christ, that was not possible. When you go back and you read in the Old Testament and you see how just the high priest was allowed once a year to go into the Holy of Holies. And there, if he was not cleansed, he was killed because he had sin in his life. But now through Jesus Christ, we can go into the Holy of Holies. We can go hallowed or holy is your name, Father. Holy is your name. We can make contact with Him. And no matter what demon is bothering us, no matter what the devil is trying to do to us, because he is a liar and a thief and he's trying to steal, kill, destroy, discourage, and everything else. He is trying to put our lives in disarray, but we can go to our Heavenly Father and we can pray. Holy is your name. We go in with a holy reverence, a God fear, a healthy fear of who God is. That's how we start our prayer life. And then he goes, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth. You see, when you get to heaven, there's no more sin, there's no more sorrow, there's no more shame, and best of all, there is no more devil. No more devil. The accuser of the brethren is not there. He was kicked out. Jesus said, I saw Satan fall like lightning. He is not there in heaven. Jesus said, I'm going to prepare a place for you that where I am, there you may be also. And he says, your kingdom come. So imagine the peace. Imagine the majesty. Imagine the wonder that is in heaven right now, where there is no sin, There is no sorrow. There is no sickness. There is no shame. And there is no devil. Can you imagine that just momentarily, briefly, just a small little bit? Jesus says you can have some of that. You can't have it all, but you can have a taste of that here and now. He says, pray that your kingdom, God's kingdom, come and your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So we need to invite the presence of God into our lives, into our families, into our business, into our communities, into our churches. We need to invite God's presence. Jesus does not just bust up in our lives and try to take over. That's not the way he does it. He says in Revelation chapter 3, verse number 20, behold, I stand at the door and knock. He's knocking. He's not kicking the door down. He's knocking. He's giving us an invitation to open the door and let him come in. Here he's doing the same thing. He's saying we need to pray for God's kingdom to come into our lives, into our families. He says, your will be done. I think it's marvelous when you look at this. Your will be done. Jesus is saying that we need to pray to the Father for his will, not our will, to be done. And do you know Jesus demonstrated that? Not going to read it to you, but I'll just remind you of it. I think it's in Matthew chapter 26 or so, when Jesus was in the garden, and he was there, and he was crying, and he was weeping before God, and his sweat, the Bible declares, became as great drops of blood. Can you imagine? I have prayed in agony before, but I've never sweat drops of blood. But Jesus prayed so earnestly, and he said, Father, he said, I would that this cup pass from me. What was he talking about? The crucifixion. He knew the shame that he was fixing to experience. He knew the embarrassment that he was fixing to experience. He knew the pain that he was fixing to experience. Why? Because he loved us enough to go to a cross. But he prayed, nevertheless, Father, not my will be done, but yours. Friend, what an example we have. What a demonstration of giving up our will. We all have a will. God created us with a will. Some people want to take that away from us. Man, you were created free to choose. I was created free to choose. We get to choose every single day who we serve, what we serve, and where we serve. The Bible declares your will be done. You see, I have to invite God's will to be done in my life. And I'll admit to you something here this morning. I'll confess, church. I have asked God at times, God, just make me do it. Just make me do it. You know I don't want to do it. Just make me do it. Yeah. Friend, he's not going to do it that way. He is not going to make us do it. We have to go through the process of crucifying our old nature and saying, self, in the name of Jesus, I bind you. Whatsoever things are bound on earth are bound in heaven. Whatsoever things are loosed on earth are loosed in heaven. In the name of Jesus, I bind that carnal nature, that sinful nature, and I loose the power of God's Holy Spirit. I loose the blood of Jesus Christ. And I ask for God's will to be done in my life. I ask for God's will to be done in this circumstance, in this situation. I ask for God's will, and I release myself to do God's will, because I'm praying, your kingdom come into my life. Your will be done in my life. Your will be done in my family. Your will be done in my ministry. Whatever it is, church, we have to invite God's kingdom and God's will here on earth just as it is in heaven. Amen? Amen. All right. Give us this day our daily bread. Give us this day our daily bread. I know I'm as guilty as anybody. When we go to the store, we buy groceries. I don't buy just a day's worth. With the price of gas, I ain't going to buy just a day's worth, because I don't want to have to go to the grocery store every day. I went and filled my old truck. Some of you have seen my old Ford, 1978 Ford truck. It's as ugly as sin, but I can tell you this, it ain't got a computer on it. When I crank it, it runs. Oh, makes me feel good. But he says, give us this day our daily bread. Filled my old truck up yesterday, and it wasn't even flat on empty either. It was $61. I said, Jesus. But you know what? He gave me a promise, or he told me to ask for something. Father, whatever I need today, not going to worry about tomorrow. What do I need today? Give us today our daily bread. My daily bread. Don't need to worry about tomorrow. Jesus goes on to say, and we'll drop down to verse 31. He says, therefore, do not worry, saying, what shall we eat? Or what shall we drink? Or what shall we wear? For all these things the Gentiles seek. Well, let me define Gentiles. Unbelievers. Unbelievers. That's what the unbelievers are after. They're worrying about all these things. What are we going to eat? What are we going to wear? What are we going to do? How much money's in the bank? How much do I have saved up for this and that? And that, all these things, they're wasting their lives and using their lives. I'm not saying don't lay up for a rainy day because it's going to rain. But friend, when we spend our time worrying over these things, when we have a promise for God or we can ask God for our daily bread, he says, your Heavenly Father, remember, how do you qualify? You must be born again. And when you're born again, your Heavenly Father knows what you need even before you ask. Nevertheless, he said, ask, seek, and knock. Your Heavenly Father knows what you need, knows that you need all these things. I don't have to tell him I'm hungry. I don't have to tell him I need money for gas. I don't have to tell him that I'm broke. I don't have to tell him any of those things. You know, and I know this may seem harsh, but it's the Bible, so I'm just going to say what it is. The Bible declares, I've never seen the righteous forsaken nor their seed begging for bread. And I have seen it. I'm, 58 years old now? Been in church most of my life. And I have watched God's people. And I've seen my mom struggle, single mom, trying to raise kids on a cotton mill budget. And for those of you that worked in the cotton mill, you know it was slim pickings. But I watched her provide, pay for a house, pay for a car, and put money in the bank off a cotton mill salary. Why? Because she trusted God for her daily need. She never worried about it. She prayed about it. You can rest assured she prayed about it. I heard her many a days and nights, agonizing in prayer. God, you know what we have need of, even before we ask. I can remember one day, I don't remember if we were needing groceries or what it was, but Mom, we didn't have any money. We were broke. And so you know what you do when you're broke? You clean house. So Mom was cleaning house. I mean, she was taking things, getting the whatnots that she had and dusting them and all this kind of stuff, and she took down a picture that was hanging up on the wall, and she started dusting the picture. And the back came off, that little cardboard piece came off. You know what was inside there? $20. $20. Mom had forgotten that she had stuck that money back there months or years earlier. But you know what? Her Heavenly Father knew what she had need of even before she asked. And God helped her to put away, unaware, what she would need for a future day. Friend, I got news for you. God knows how to take care of His children. Your Heavenly Father knows that you need. And so He's got everything in control. There's a story in the Old Testament. I think it was Elijah. God instructed him, and he obeyed God. He obeyed God rather than man. And God ended up putting him out there on a creek bank. He drank water every single day. And the crows would bring bread to him. And he ate bread, and he drank water. And he may have had a fish every now and then, but he didn't go without. He may not have had steak and potatoes every day, but he did not starve to death in that wilderness. Why? He was following God's plan. Church, I want you to know, I have never seen the righteous forsaken, nor their seed begging for bread. Jesus says, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. Whatever your need is, clothing, God's got it. It may not come from some name brand. You may not, and I don't know. I wanted to. Went and bought one of my grand boys some shoes the other day. He said, what's the limit? I said, $100, brother. He did good, $70-something, so I was proud of him. I remember Mama used to get upset with me. I was rough on shoes. I remember growing up on a farm, and I wish we had those days. I do, but we don't. But I do like to reminisce. Growing up on a farm, you had two pair of shoes. You had your school shoes and you had your Sunday shoes. Rest of the time, you was barefoot. And Mama, once her and Dad got a divorce, we moved into the city. I had to have shoes all the time for some reason. I don't know why. But anyway, man, she'd buy me a new pair of shoes. I remember going down to the store, and she'd buy me some shoes, and I'd put them on my feet. Within a week, them things looked like they had been drugged through a mud hole. Woo, she'd get fired up. Boy, I'm going to tell you what, I'm going to just, and never mind. Jesus says the most important thing in life beside our needs is our relationship. Our relationship with God. He said the most important thing is not what we wear, not what we eat, not where we live, not what we drive. He says, but seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Seek first. First priority, the greatest priority of humanity is relationship with God Almighty. And it can only happen through the person of Jesus Christ. He said, and if we'll put God first, church, I'm telling you, you've seen it. Many of you have seen it. Some of you will see it if you'll let God. If we'll put God first, he'll take care. He promises right here. If we'll put him first, he'll take care of everything else in our life. Everything. Our needs. And I can tell you, he'll even give you some of your wants every now and then. Not often, but every now and then. But we got to put him first. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these other things shall be added to you. He says in verse 34, he says, therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about its own things. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble. Don't worry. And I know I probably shouldn't mention it, but I like that little jingle song, Don't Worry, Be Happy. Yeah? You ever heard that one? Who hadn't, right? Don't worry. Why? Because if you worry about it and it never happens, you've worried in vain. If you worry about it and it does happen, then you've worried about it twice. You worried about it before it got there, and then you worried about it when it got there, and you'll be worried about it when it leaves. Oh, I hope it don't come back. Jesus says, do not worry. Don't do it. It's not worth it. Bad for your health. Bad for your mentality, I can tell you that. Make you, I know some of you think I'm already there, but it'll make you nuts. It will drive you crazy. Trying to figure out the what ifs and what can happen and what will happen, what might happen and all that. Man, just forget about it. Live life one day at a time. Quit trying to live tomorrow on today's time, because you may not have tomorrow. We got today. Let's live today. Don't worry about it. Then, back to the prayer. Jesus says, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Now, what does that mean? I know a lot of times when we use this translation and we think about debts and debtors, think about owing people money. And that may be true in a sense. I've had people forgive me of debt before, money debt before. I have forgiven other people of money debt before. But Jesus is talking about something much deeper than that. He's talking about bearing grudges, holding on to bitterness and unforgiveness. And when people have hurt us, and I'm talking about hurt us, some of you know what I'm talking about. You have been injured so deeply. I'm talking lifelong scar. It's something that you'll never get over. You may not get over it, but you can get through it. Jesus says, forgive us. So we're asking our Heavenly Father, Father, forgive me of offending you and hurting you and sinning against you and doing all these things against you. Forgive me. And you know what we want to hear? You are forgiven. You're forgiven. That's what we want to hear. That Jesus didn't, he didn't put a period there, he put a comma. Forgive us our debts, comma, because it hinges, the comma, after the comma, hinges. As we forgive our debtors. So in order for me to get forgiven of my debt, and you got to be careful here, listen, when you come to Jesus Christ, just like that newborn babe does not know how to run, does not know how to read, does not know how to write, does not know how to do a lot of things, God will graciously give us time to grow up, to mature as believers until such time as we have the knowledge and the wisdom to do what needs to be done. You see, our youngest grandchild, Macy, she is in the stage of learning. She doesn't know. She has to be taught. And so we're teaching her. A lot of times it's no, and sometimes it's yes, and all, but she's having to learn that when Mimi or Pawpaw or Mom or Dad says no, then it's no. When we say yes, it's yes. When we say go, it's go. When we say stop, it's stop. But she's having to learn painfully through that process, gaining that ability to obey. When we become children of God, God gives us time and space for maturing, for growing up. And when we come to the knowledge one day that, hey, I've got a grudge against somebody, I've got hard feelings against somebody, they hurt me. And listen, when we forgive them, doesn't mean that we agree with what they've done. It doesn't mean that we are letting them off. It means we are breaking the chains that are keeping us bound. It's not freeing them, it's freeing us. Jesus says, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And then he explains it after he says, amen. He says, for if you forgive men their trespasses, he calls it here, trespasses. You know what trespassing is? When you go somewhere you have no authority to go. People came into your life, they had no business hurting you, no business stomping on your heart, no business crushing your dreams, no business doing whatever it is that they did, no business trespassing, but they came anyway. They came without your permission. They came without authority. They trespassed. If you forgive men their trespasses, your Heavenly Father will also forgive you. Whoo, man, that's hard. I know some of you, like me, you've been hurt deeply, wounded, broken. But here it is. Jesus said it. I didn't. If you forgive, your Heavenly Father will also forgive you. My freedom counts on me obeying God, doing what he's called me to do, and forgiving those who have trespassed, those who have hurt, those who have injured. And I can tell you in a lifetime, friend, there's going to be many of them. Many of them. Here's the warning. Jesus says, if you do not forgive men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. Nobody wants that, right? We all want forgiveness. So if we want it, we got to give it. And there again, it's not getting them off the hook. They still got to stand before God. They still have to give an account for what they did, what they said, the wrong that they committed. They still have to give an account, but it simply breaks the shackles, the chains off of us spiritually so that we can live in freedom. I know I've told this story many times. After this sanctuary was built, what was it, 2004? I think we moved into this new sanctuary. I was on my face right over here in the altar. And I was wrestling. I was miserable. Pastor Mark came over to me and put his arm around me. He said, "Ricky, what's going on?" I said, "Brother, it's like I'm taking one step forward and two steps back. I just can't seem to get past this hang-up in my life, this hindrance in my life." And so he prayed with me, and God revealed what was going on. I had unforgiveness in my life. I had bitterness in my life. And I'm talking about, I wanted somebody to go to hell. I wanted them to burn for eternity because of the deepness of which they had hurt me. And God said, "Ricky, I'm not going to let you advance with me until you deal with that unforgiveness. I couldn't do anything else until I dealt with that." I call it the rubber band effect. It's like there is a giant rubber band wrapped around you, and it is pegged down to that one issue. And you can bypass it all day long if you want to. You can say, "I am not going to deal with that today. I don't want to deal with it. It hurts, brings up bad memories, bad thoughts. I do not want to think about him, her, them, whatever. I'm just going to bypass it." And so you go around it, and you begin to go on with your life. Well, you know what happens when that rubber band gets tighter and tighter and tighter. One day, the pressure is going to be so great, and that rubber band, I promise you, is of God, and it's not going to break. You're not going to get away from it. The pressures of life are going to become so great because of that one issue. He is going to snatch you back, and it's going to be a crash right there, and you're going to be faced with it all over again. God will get you free from it when you and I and we obey God. When we forgive, God helps us and frees us, because I can tell you, those people that I had the hang-up over, that I had the bitterness, that I had the resentment, that I had just hatred for, I'm free now. I'm free. You talk about God doing a work, but God got me to a place where I could just cry in agony, praying for their souls and praying for God to save them. I don't know if they ever got saved. I know some of them's dead, but I'm telling you, friend, God can set you free. Do not let him have to take you down that rubber band road over and over and over, because he is not going to let you advance until you deal with it. If we forgive, we can have forgiveness. Go on back. Quit meddling. All right. Last one. Do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Jesus says, do not lead us into temptation. Now, you have some that want to change the wording in the Bible. I don't think we should change the wording in the Bible. I like it the way it was written 2,000 years ago as far as the New Testament. What is Jesus talking about? Because the Bible is clear. James, the book of James tells us, he says, God cannot be tempted with sin, and he's not going to tempt you with sin. So we're not asking God not to lead us into temptation. We're asking God to lead us in a direction, and He will. I promise you, He will never lead you to temptation. If somebody says, and they're doing something that's sinful and doing something that's wrong, and my Lord, I have seen this so many times. Well, God opened the door. No, He didn't. The devil opened the door and you took the bait. God is not going to lead us into temptation. He's not going to lead us into sin. He never has and He never will. God cannot be tempted with sin, and He's not going to tempt us with sin. Temptation comes from the devil. Lead us not into temptation. God, I want to follow You in everything that I do, everywhere that I go. Deliver us from the evil one. Who's He talking about? The devil. Deliver us from him. Why? He's a crafty old guy, ain't he? Genesis chapter 1 and 2, everything was wonderful. Everything was hunky-dory. Genesis chapter 3, here comes a snake. Slithers in. You ever noticed Adam and Eve was not alarmed? They were not alarmed because there was a snake in the garden. They had seen snakes before and they'd never hurt them, never messed with them, never bothered them. But now here is Satan and he has embodied a serpent. And he comes in there and he says, hey, why don't you eat of that tree? And they begin the conversation. And you know the story. Here we are. And I don't know if God will give you permission. But when you get to heaven, if Adam and Eve are there, and if you want to smack them in the head, go ahead. I'd like to. Man, look at the pain and the misery. Ladies, you have pain in childbirth now because of Adam and Eve. Smack them both in the head. The ground, it's not just Lee County, it's Chambers County too. There's thorns, there's weeds, it's just stuff, hard ground that you got to work hard to dig in. And all because of the evil one. All the misery that's in the world, some people say, if God is a loving God, why doesn't He just stop all this? He didn't start it. He didn't start it. The snake, the evil one, started it. And it's because we keep believing his lies, we keep believing his deceptions, this trouble goes on and on and on. This pain goes on and on and on. Why? Because of the evil one. And so the prayer is, Lord, Father, deliver us from the evil one. When temptation comes along from the devil, deliver us. Help us to see him for what he is. He's a devil. He's a snake in the grass. Help us to see him for what he is and not be deceived. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. You see, it's God's kingdom. Remember, your kingdom come, it's coming, and hell can't stop it. It's coming, and government can't stop it. It's coming, and the world can't stop it. God's kingdom is coming, and Satan hates it, but it's coming. But his kingdom is coming, and he does. All the power is his. Always has been. He's never relinquished it. Jesus has the keys of death and hell. He didn't have to take it away from anybody. He's got the power. All power and authority has been given to him. And his glory is going to be forever. I can't wait until that day when that old serpent, the evil one, the devil, I know he's going to be locked away for 1,000 years during the millennial reign, but I want it. I want to see it. Man, I want to see both. I really do. I want to see when the angel binds that old devil, Lucifer, and throws him into that bottomless pit. I'm praying God just bounce his head off the gate there. Just bam, bam, bam. Just let him bounce off the walls for 1,000 years. But then when he's loose for a time to deceive, and I don't understand all of that, that's crazy. If humanity is allowed to live for 1,000 years in just peace and harmony, why would you listen to this devil when he comes out? But that's not for us. That's not for us. You see, right now, here's what we need to know. Our Father is in heaven. If you have accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, your Father is in heaven. He loves you. I heard one preacher put it like this. If God had a refrigerator, your picture would be hanging on it. Amen. You know how we are. It's hard. It's hard for me. I get around my grandkids and I start taking pictures. The little trip that Whit and I took up to Lookout Mountain, Chattanooga area. Didn't even get out of the driveway. I'm taking pictures, you know. I'm smile, boy. And then I think it was like 158 pictures later. Whit was saying, "Papa, you always taking pictures." I'm, yeah, buddy, in 20 years you ain't going to remember this, but I got proof that I took you somewhere, spent some money on you. I want you to remember. Listen, God loves you. He does. Your Heavenly Father loves you. He's for you. He's not against you. You say, "But Brother Icky, I'm messed up." Friend, I think we all do. I know some of you don't mess up as much as I do, but I'm telling you, just like we preached on last Sunday, His mercy is brand new every day. It does not give us permission to go and fill up our sin bucket, so to speak, and come back next Sunday and dump it out again. That's not it at all. It gives us an opportunity to get up and try again when we fail. Our Father does not fail. We do, but He does not. So love your Heavenly Father. Go to your Heavenly Father. Ask Him for His kingdom to come, His will to be done in your life. And let Him have control and let Him take care of all the worries, all the anxieties, all the what-ifs and the maybes and the mights and all that stuff. And ask for His kingdom and His power to be done in our lives. Amen. Amen. All right, let's bow our heads in prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, sir, thank you for this day. Thank you for this message. Thank you for not only teaching us to pray, but Lord, giving us the information that we need to know that there is not just a God in heaven, but our Father who is in heaven. And you're not just in heaven some light years away or wherever heaven is. Father, you're right here, right now. You know the cares and the concerns of every human being on this planet. Lord, help me to remind everybody in the sound of my voice, He knows your cares right now. He knows your pain, your heartache, your sorrow. He knows your joy. He knows everything about you. I would even go so far as to say that He knows us better than we know ourselves. And He loves us. Father, thank you for loving us with a love that we cannot fathom. And there is no height, no depth, no width, no breadth. Nothing on earth, nothing in heaven can separate us from your love. You think about us more than the sand that is by the seashore. Thank you, Father, for loving us in such a way. And Lord, if there's someone here today, if there's someone watching online who does not know you as Father, right now, in Jesus' name, Lord, knock on their heart. Knock on their heart's door. Sir, ma'am, young person, if Jesus is knocking on your heart's door right now, you have two choices. Turn him away or let him in. And I pray that you would open the door and let him in. Don't just let him in, but invite him in. Open the door to your heart and say, yes, Jesus, come into my life. Come into my soul. Come into my heart. Forgive me of my sins. Help me to repent and turn away from sin. Turn away from the evil that the enemy has brought into my life. He has deceived me. And Lord, now you have shown your light and I can see. And I can see that I need a Savior. And I want Father God to be my Father. Forgive me of my sins. Cleanse me. Wash me. Write my name in the Lamb's Book of Life. And Lord, help me from this day forward to live for you. To let you be the Lord of my life. For your Holy Spirit to come into me and baptize me in the power that is available. And God, help me every single day to live for you and to let your will be done in my life. Lord, I love you and I accept the fact that I'm a sinner, but you died for my sins. I accept the fact that you rose victorious over death and hell on the third day, and because you live, I can live also. And Lord, I thank you that now I am a child of God, and I am forgiven, and I am free, and you will continue to work in my life each and every day. And you love me now and always, and I receive that with great thanksgiving and gratefulness. In Jesus' name. And let all of God's children say amen and amen. Thank you. If you prayed that prayer and opened your heart to Jesus, please fill out a connection card. Let me know. You just drop it in the bucket on the way out. I'll be praying for you. I will contact you. I got a gift for you, a book to help you kind of get along, get on down the road. And we'll encourage you to be baptized in water. That is your public profession. I'm not going to call you up front to do it, but we'll do the baptism, and that's the way you're telling everybody, Jesus is my Lord and my Savior, and Father God is my Father in heaven. Amen? All right. Pine Grove, you love Jesus? He loves you. God bless you. Go and have a good day. Take care.